Welcome to this lesson on local linear approximation. And by the way, that's a subject name that sounds much more complicated than it really is. And what I want to show you in the next few minutes is that local linear approximation really just means using the definition of what a derivative is in order to make a prediction. That's what it really boils down to. And to help you build some intuition behind this, I want to start just with an example. So suppose that at noon, right, so that's 12 hours, 0 minutes, and 0 seconds into the day, noon, a car is 0 miles east of St. Paul, Minnesota, and begins driving east at 60 miles per hour. And what we could try to do is estimate the car's position at different times. So if we were to ask what's going on at 1 p.m., we would guess that, well, 1 hour has passed since we started keeping track of things. We're 1 hour after noon, and the car, at least at that time, was driving at 60 miles per hour. 1 hour times 60 miles per hour is 60 miles. And then we could ask, you know, what's our confidence in that prediction that the car is 60 miles east of St. Paul? And I would say our confidence is pretty low. Why? Well, there's a lot that could happen in an hour. The car could speed up, it could slow down, it could turn and go a different direction, it could stop completely and take a break and then start again, right? So it's a pretty long amount of time. All we can do is use that piece of information we had to make a guess, but we have relatively little confidence in that guess. Okay, what if instead we ask what's going on at 12:10? That's 10 minutes after we started. 10 minutes is 1/6 of an hour. So we would estimate 1/6 of an hour times 60 miles per hour is 10 miles. And so our best guess would be that the car's position was 10 miles east of St. Paul at 10 minutes after noon. And we can ask again what our confidence is in that prediction. And I would say it's somewhat better than the previous guess, but it's still not great because even in 10 minutes a lot could happen. Car could speed up, slow down, stop, turn and go a different direction, right? We don't really know, but it's the best guess we can make given the information we have. Okay, what about 1 minute? 1 minute after noon? Well, a minute is 1/60 of an hour. So you would estimate that 1/60 of an hour times 60 miles per hour is 1 mile. We would guess that the car is 1 mile east of the center of St. Paul. And we would have a bit more confidence in that prediction, right? There's less of a chance in that 1 minute that the car would have started, stopped, sped up very much, slowed down very much, changed direction, and so on. And finally, we can ask, what if we just look 5 seconds? 5 seconds after noon. Well, 5 seconds is 1/720 of an hour. So 1/720 of an hour times 60 miles per hour is 1/12 of a mile. And our guess would be that the car is 1/12 of a mile east of St. Paul. And I would say we would have pretty good confidence in that. In those 5 seconds, we might assume, you know, the car just kept on doing what it's doing. Okay, this is the whole idea of what local linear approximation is. It just means using some data about a function and its derivative in order to make a prediction. And the intuition I tried to build in this previous example is that the closer the value of the independent variable for the prediction is to the value for the data we have, the more confidence we have in our prediction, right? So when we were trying to predict only 5 seconds into the future, we had a pretty good degree of confidence. We thought this is probably a pretty good approximation. But an hour into the future, we thought, well, there's no reason to expect that our prediction is very good. So let's try to make this a little bit more mathematical now. Suppose that we have a function f of x, and we have a particular value of x in mind. We're going to call it x equals a. Okay, so a is like the time noon in our previous example. And suppose that we also happen to know the value of the function there. We know f of a, and we know the value of the derivative, f prime of a. Then for nearby values of x, we can make the local linear approximation, and that approximation is that f of x is approximately equal to f of a plus the derivative times the difference between x and a. Okay? And again, I want to sort of tie this closely. You know, I'm not a big fan of memorization, so I want to give you intuition so that you don't end up blindly memorizing this. And the intuition I want you to have is that, you know, think of this as trying to predict distance at a certain time like in our previous example. And this is distance at the initial time, okay, which in the previous example was 0. Okay, and then this is sort of like your speed. It's like how fast you were driving at that time. And this is sort of like the additional amount of time that you drove. Right? It's the difference between the time at which you're trying to predict something and the time where you had all your information. So it says your distance should be approximately what your original distance was plus your speed times the extra amount that you drove. That's all local linear approximation is, and that's all that this formula says. So let's go ahead and apply this. Suppose there's a mountain climber who's 6,000 meters down trail. Okay, so they've walked along a mountain trail for 6,000 meters. And at that point, it so happens that the mountain climber, she is 8,000 meters above sea level. And then we can imagine that there's some function h of x. And it tells us that at x meters down trail from the start, the elevation of the trail is h of x meters. Okay, we don't have a formula for this function, we just imagine that there is one. Okay, then we imagine that we try to measure the slope of the trail, and that we find out that at our current point where we're standing at 6,000 meters, that the slope of the trail is about 0.5. So that's the derivative of h, right? It says if we were to go another meter down trail, the height above sea level would go up by 1/2. And we would like to use this information to estimate what is the approximate elevation another 3 meters along the trail from the point of 6,000 meters where we're currently standing. So again, here's what we're going to do. We're going to make an estimate. And the estimate is that the height a little bit more down trail is approximately equal to the height where we're standing now plus the slope at that point, or the derivative at that point, times the additional amount that we walk down trail, right? So then, once we understand that, we just need to plug in a little bit. So our prediction is that we would like to know h at 6,003 meters down trail. It's approximately equal to the height 6,000 meters down, plus the derivative at that point, times 6,003 minus 6,000, which represents our additional 3 meters down trail we walked. And now we just have to figure out how to plug in the information we were given. Well, we're told that h of 6,000 is 8,000, so we can substitute it there. We're told that h prime at 6,000 is 1/2. And we're told, or we can compute rather easily, that 6,003 minus 6,000 is 3. So our final answer is 8,000 plus 1/2 times 3, which is simply 8,001.5 meters. We can do a really similar calculation, but for going backwards, right? We could ask, what's the approximate elevation 2 meters backwards along the trail from where we are? And it's the exact same process, right? We're going to estimate that at 5,998 meters along the trail, the elevation should be whatever it was at 6,000 meters plus the derivative at that point times 5,998 minus 6,000, which means we're moving backwards by 2 meters. And if we plug in that information, h of 6,000, once again, is 8,000. The derivative, once again, is 0.5. And now we've moved 2 meters backwards, or minus 2 meters, along the trail. So that would be 8,000 plus 1/2 of negative 2, which, of course, is 7,999 meters elevation. Okay. In case you're a geometric person and you'd like a quick picture to help explain to you what you're doing when you're doing local linear approximation, for a function of one variable, what you're really doing is you're using the tangent line to a function at a point to make a prediction about the function at a different point. And I don't want to belabor this, but if you get something out of this picture, then it's something nice to keep in mind. So basically, here's a function, f of x, right? And here's the tangent line. Okay, and what we're doing is we're saying we'd like to look a little bit away from the point of tangency. At the point of tangency, the function and the tangent line are equal to each other. They have the same y-coordinate. But if you go a little bit further to the right, we can look and see that the value of the tangent line is up here, whereas the real value, the actual value of the function, is down here, and they're a little bit different, right? There's some difference between them, which is why this is an approximation of this. Now, the reason you would do this ever is that you might not always have the formula for f of x, right? You might have incomplete information, and you need to make a prediction about something away from the point where you have information. So that's why you would do this. I'm just showing you a full picture of the function so that you can see that the value of your prediction from the tangent line and the value of the function have some difference between them. Of course, the closer you make your prediction to the original value where you had information, right, the closer those two things will be. So if we only looked a little bit to the right, you know, the value of the function would be here, the value of the tangent line would be here, those two things are much closer together, right? So we would have more confidence in our prediction. Now, it turns out this works the exact same way for functions of multiple variables, except that now you have to accumulate, you have to add up the change in the output of the function due to changing potentially more than one input variable. So let me quickly show you how this works. The idea is that if you have a function f of x and y, and you have particular values in mind, say x equals a and y equals b, and you also suppose that at that point a, b, you know the value of the function and the value of the partial derivatives. So that's f sub x and f sub y, right? Since it's a function of two variables, there are two partial derivatives. And we imagine that we know both of the values. Then for nearby values of x and y, we make a prediction. And the prediction is that the value of the function at the new point is approximately equal to the value of the function at our original point plus your change in x times the partial derivative in x plus the change in y times the partial derivative in y. And in case that's a little bit too much notation or a little bit confusing for you, let's do an example, because I think the example makes it really clear. So this example is about wind chill, which you may have seen in a previous screencast. Wind chill is basically how cold it feels to you. And it depends on two things. It depends on the temperature T in degrees, the real temperature outside, and it depends on the wind speed or the wind velocity V in miles per hour. And suppose we know the following things. It's currently 5 degrees out, and the wind speed is 25, and the wind chill is minus 17 degrees Fahrenheit. That's how cold it feels to us. It's substantially colder than the real temperature of 5 because the wind speed is so high. And suppose we also know partial derivatives. Partial derivative of wind chill with respect to temperature is 1.3 degrees Fahrenheit per degree Fahrenheit. And please remember what that means. It means that for every degree Fahrenheit that the real temperature goes up, the wind chill goes up by 1.3. It feels 1.3 degrees warmer to us. Similarly, the partial derivative of wind chill with respect to wind speed is minus 0.4 degrees Fahrenheit per mile per hour. And what that means is that for every mile per hour that the wind picks up, it feels 0.4 degrees Fahrenheit colder to us. And what we would like to do is to estimate the wind chill based on this information, estimate the wind chill if the temperature is 7 degrees Fahrenheit and the wind speed is 22 miles per hour. So we'd like to estimate W of 7, 22. And to do it, we'll use our local linear approximation. Local linear approximation says that the value of the function at the point we're trying to predict is the value of the function at the point where we have all the information plus the change that happens due to varying temperature, plus the change that happens due to varying wind speed. And let's just fill in some of those things, right? So the wind chill at 7 degrees Fahrenheit and 22 miles per hour wind speed is just the wind chill at the original point, 5 degrees and 25 miles per hour, plus the partial derivative at that point times the change in temperature. The old temperature was 5 and the new temperature is 7, plus the partial derivative with respect to wind speed at that point times the change in wind speed. And the old wind speed was 25 and the new wind speed is 22. All right, so we can fill things in. Our original value of the function at 525 was a wind chill of minus 17. What we've done now is raise the temperature by 2. Right? We went from 5 to 7, so we raised it by 2, so we have to account for the fact of the partial derivative that every degree we raise the temperature raises the wind chill by 1.3. So we're going to multiply 1.3 by 2. Similarly, we changed the wind speed. We lowered it from 25 to 22. We made the wind speed lower. So our change in wind speed was -3. And then we remember the fact that for every mile per hour that we increase wind speed, the wind chill should go down by 0.4. And the thing to notice here is that there's two minus signs, right? So when we multiply by -3 by -0.4, we get something positive, and that makes sense, right? We lowered the wind speed, so it should feel warmer to us. This negative times a negative equaling a positive is going to result in a warmer temperature. So when we carry out all of this arithmetic, we go ahead and we get the final answer that the wind chill is approximately -13.2 degrees Fahrenheit. Again, higher than our original wind chill of -17 degrees Fahrenheit. All right, so we've reached the end of this lesson, and I want you to ask yourself if you can do the following things. You should be able to explain the idea of a local linear approximation, just in plain English words. What is it that you're trying to do? You should be able to recognize when a given situation is a local linear approximation problem, right? You want to know when you can apply this technique. You would like to be able to perform local linear approximation for functions of one and two variables. And you'd like to be able to give a geometric interpretation of local linear approximation for at least for a single variable function. We didn't talk about the higher variable interpretations because it has to do with understanding planes and hyperplanes and things that I think aren't really necessary for our discussion. But I think that that intuition, at least in a one-dimensional world or a world where there's one independent variable, f of x, that's really helpful to give you some insight into what you're actually doing. So that's it, and thanks for listening to this lesson.